Good afternoon. I'm Patty Brennan, the director of the National Library of Medicine, and today I'm excited to have you join me in a conversation with one of our most distinguished investigators, Dr. Eugene Koonin. Today our conversation is going to travel through a wide range of ideas from the communication of cells across time to the comparison of viruses and other cellular life. Dr. Koonin's thinking about how various life forms evolve over time has been instrumental in driving many discoveries in contemporary biology. Did you start out experimentally or computationally to study viruses, or did they become a serviceable, good model for you to study evolution?
I started my career as an experimental virologist, trying to study RNA viruses, maybe without outstanding success. But soon after, these RNA viruses have indeed become an excellent, probably best at the time, playground for the emerging discipline of comparative genomics, because for the simple reasons that at the time, these were the complete genomes that could be sequenced.
What got you into the computational tools for understanding viruses?
The first complete genomes of any biological entities have started to accumulate. And these biological entities at the time were exclusively small viruses. Uh-huh. And these represented both an opportunity and a challenge. An opportunity because these were complete genomes to compare and try to understand. A challenge because without special effort, without developing dedicated computational approaches, very little could be understood from those sequences. I don't think that the community at the time was entirely prepared for that situation. But that was rectified fairly soon. And I'm very pleased to have played some role in that.
Well, we've talked before about your interest in genomic evolution and that the manner in which organisms change over time. And I'd like you to talk a little bit about that now, and if you could specifically talk a little bit about the challenge of understanding conservation versus mutation.
All genomes that exist on our planet result from billions and millions of years of evolution. To put it very simply, when we compare genomes of either closely related or distantly related organisms, we delineate conserved and less conserved variable parts. And what we can see is that the highly conserved parts are involved in functions that are essential for the organism's survival. Conversely, the parts that are variable contain genes that are involved in interactions between organisms and in interactions between organisms and the environment. Mm-hmm.
So when you speak about conserved, this is not only sections of the gene that appear over generations of the organism, but also that appear commonly across groups of organisms.
It's useful to note that by now it's a firmly established plain fact that all cellular organisms, I'm not talking about viruses, all cellular organisms that exist on this planet originate from a single common ancestor, so-called LUCA, last universal cellular ancestor, that existed about 4 billion years ago, or just a little bit less, maybe. This was probably the most brilliant hypothesis in the history of science proposed by none other than Charles Darwin. The entire history of life, the unimaginably long history of life on our planet, spanning about 4 billion years, is permeated by persisting evolutionary relationships. To be even a little more specific, there is about 100 of genes that are shared by all cellular organisms, from mammals to plants to amoeba to bacteria.
I'm going to turn our attention to your experiences here at the National Library of Medicine. You've been here 30 years?
And yeah, actually, even a little longer.
A little longer?
Exactly 31. No.
31 years. And you have had an illustrious career, many trainees and many, many, many papers. I wonder if you can talk a little bit about how the National Library of Medicine's resources have shaped your work and how you have helped shape our resources.
It has been an incredibly welcoming and fertile environment for the evolution of my own scientific career, my research group, and combines very good resources with pretty much unlimited academic freedom, which sounds almost too good to be true, but nevertheless is true.
You spoke at one time of the importance of the BLAST algorithm for your work and then further modifications of that. Could you speak a little bit about the analytical tools that you use and what we provide for that?
BLAST is a centerpiece of computational biology and genomics, a completely indispensable tool which quickly compares sequences of nucleic acids and proteins. And there are, at the time of its development, which incidentally coincided with my arrival here,
yes.
This was by far superior by any other available methods and was actually the only real game in town, the only way to efficiently compare gene and genomic sequences. Very timely development. I don't think that any other tool or method developed here really compares with BLAST in importance. It should be noted, however, that there is substantial competition in the world now that hopefully advances the field as a whole.
I'd like you to reflect for a moment on the contribution that you delight in the most in your scientific career.
Perhaps I should mention the CRISPR system. What CRISPR is widely known because this is known as the new methodology for genome engineering and editing, which is far more efficient and fast than previously available ones, but in biology itself, this is something also of great interest, because CRISPR is an adoptive immunity system in microbes, in bacteria. Before this was discovered, no one even suspected that adoptive immunity, fundamentally similar to our own, existed in a bacteria. And with my colleagues, through comparative genomics approaches, as usual, we have been instrumental into the discovery and further characterization of this system. Many labs contributed, but I think our contribution is noticeable.
I want to close by congratulating you on your election to the National Academy of Medicine this year. I was quite proud to have another member of our NLM staff become recognized so widely for critical contributions, and I congratulate you personally.
Thank you so much. It's certainly a great honor.